Welcome to Harper McKine Elementary School Beach Club at Home. We're going to study the story of Jesus and the resurrection, and I was really hoping that we were going to be able to share this with you on Thursday in April, like we've done every Thursday during the school year. But unfortunately, with the coronavirus and all of the restrictions that have come about because of that, we decided to go ahead and bring Kids Beach Club to your home. And so today we're going to spend a little bit of time doing some of the things we always do. We like to sing. We like to get into God's Word. We like to get into Bible stories to understand Jesus a little bit more about Him. We're hoping that not only will we have our Kids Beach Club kids here in Long Beach, but we're hoping also that the First Baptist Church children will join us and be able to watch this. And also, we've got some friends all the way across the ocean in the island of Fiji, and we're hoping that they're going to be able to join us as well. So we're hoping that this Easter celebration, that this resurrection celebration, will be something that we can all come together and enjoy, knowing that everyone is still sitting at home, not able to get together, not able to have fellowship and to be able to do the things we normally would do at Easter time. The Easter story really is the greatest story in the Bible. The Easter story is about God's love. It's about how much He loved us all the way back from creation. God knew that we would need a Savior. God knew that we needed to be able to see what He's like, to understand His character. And what better way to do that than to send Jesus to come and to live, to demonstrate, to talk about what is God like? How much does He truly love us? And when He went to the cross, what better demonstration of His love for us? Our Bible story today is going to be in John chapter 19, verses 17, all the way to chapter 20, verse 18. Now, I hope you have your Bibles with you. But if you don't, there's a pause button. Pause this and go get your Bibles. Why? Because you need your Bible for the story. You need to be able to say, where is it? How can I find it? Maybe you want to even share the story later on with somebody else. And they may say, oh, that isn't there in the Bible. Oh, yes, it is. Let me show you. You also need it because we're going to have one of my favorite Bible verses, John 3:16. And I want you to be able to turn to it and look at the words in your Bible. Again, we study God's Word. We memorize God's Word. And then we want to share God's Word with others. But in order to share it, you got to be able to find it. You also will need it when we do some Bible drill later on. You can't do Bible drill if you don't have a Bible. What do you mean you don't have a Bible? Go borrow one from mom or dad if you don't have one. And in fact, guys and gals, you need a Bible. Even if it's a New Testament, you need to be able to get into God's Word, to get to know Him, to get to understand Him, and to find out how much He loves you and the plan that He has for your life. So, if you don't have a Bible, go get one. In just a minute, Miss Donna's going to come and share some music with us. I love music.
Hello, children. Miss Stacy couldn't be here today, but we're going to do one of her favorite songs, a song that she has already taught you. And from the way you sing it so enthusiastically, I think it may be one of your favorites, too. It is one of mine. It's called The Way. Are you ready?
Yeah.
boys and girls, I believe that the Easter story that we're about to share with you is the most important story in the Bible. Only the Son of God can die and come back to life. And only the Son of God can pay the price for our sins. After all, it required a sinless individual, and the only one that's ever lived that's sinless is Jesus. And so we're going to look at a perfect man, Jesus. We're going to understand that he came and died in our place on the cross. Can you imagine just for a moment what it would be like if Jesus actually came and shared his story? It might be something like this.
Children, it's so good to see you today. Do you remember me when I came to wash the disciples' feet, when I came to visit you? Well, the Heavenly Father has sent me to earth to tell you what he's like, to tell you of his tremendous love for you. In fact, today's story, Bible verse, and character word is focusing on love. Let's think about it for just a minute. What does it mean to love somebody? If I were to say, I love you, what does that actually look like? What does that mean? Well, let me take just a few moments to tell you what I did to show you that I love you. In the beginning of our story, we're going to go all the way back to the beginning with Adam and Eve and how they sinned against God. Their sin separated them from God and caused them to be separated forever. They experienced death for the very first time. You see, the reality is that sin not only separates us from God, but it causes physical and spiritual death. We decided that something had to be done. Something had to be done because we love you. And we didn't want to see anyone, any person, to live and die and not know the Lord. We decided to do something very unexpected. But that's okay, because I'm willing to do anything to ensure that all people will be able to have a love relationship with God, just like we had with Adam and Eve in the very beginning. So here's the plan. There was a woman. Her name was Mary. She loved God and had a pure heart. And we decided that she would be the perfect mother for the Son of God. She became pregnant by the Holy Spirit with me. And for this reason, I was born. For this reason, I came into the world to show you how much the Father loves you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Well, let me continue with my story. I lived in Nazareth, the son of a carpenter, but I was keenly aware of the calling on my life, my life's purpose, my life's mission. And when I was 30 years old, I went down to the Jordan River and was baptized by John the Baptist, and I began my earthly ministry. I taught people what God was like, I healed the sick, and I did many miracles. But because I was claiming to be God in the flesh, the religious leaders had me arrested. They said that the punishment for claiming to be God was to be put to death. I freely admitted that the Father and I were one in the same. That made them very angry. They put me on trial. And Pilate, the governor, he couldn't find any fault in me. But the religious leaders pressured him to put me to death. And so he ordered me to be put to death by crucifixion. It's okay. Don't be sad. Because remember, that's the reason why I came to earth to begin with. It was difficult. It was painful. But I was willing to do it because I love you. They beat me and they nailed me to the cross. You see, children, there's the marks where the nails went through my hands, and I have ones on my feet as well. And I said to my Father, Father, it is finished. The plan that we had for me to come to earth to die on the cross for the sins of all the people in all the world is complete. My blood has paid the price. They deserve death for their sin. But, oh, Father, I have paid it for them. After I died, they put me in a tomb. And that's kind of like a cave, a small cave, where after someone died, they would put them in there. And they'd take this great big stone and roll it in front of it. And they thought that was the end. But my friend, it was just the beginning. Death, where is your victory? Death, where is your sting? The grave could not hold me, because I am the creator of heaven and earth. I am, have the power over death, because I am the living God. So children, I am here alive and well. I have come to urge you to believe, to confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, and you will be saved because I paid it for you. But in order to receive that, you have to repent and trust me with your life. Now I'm going to explain that a little bit more in just a minute. But I heard that Miss Lynn made each one of you a cross with all the colors that represent the part of our story. So if you have one of those, I want you to stop and go get it. It's going to help you to remember the entire gospel message. Now, she made me a large one so that you could see the colors better. So the very first color that I want you to find in your cross is the black one. The black represents the sin in your life. Because when you're a sinner, you live in darkness. You are condemned to live a life without a love relationship with God. Everyone has sinned, and the payment or punishment for that sin is death. All right, now for the good news. I want you to take your cross and find the red color in your cross. You see mine? That's the good news. You see, I came to earth to pay that price for you. You couldn't pay it yourselves. I am the only one who's perfect and sinless because I am God. The Heavenly Father would only accept my sacrifice because it's perfect and sinless. So on to the next color. It's the color white. Find your white on your cross. That represents you accepting my sacrifice as a payment for your sin. When you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and confess with your mouth that you're a sinner and ask Him to forgive you, the Heavenly Father will forgive you. Your sins are washed away as if you had never sinned. You can then begin a love relationship with God. So moving on, can you see the green color in my cross? Find the green color in your cross. The green represents you growing to become more like God every day. You grow and become more like God when you read my word, when you pray to me and confess your sins, and little by little, you learn to trust me with all of your life. So I'm wondering today, is there anyone listening today who wants to give their life to the Lord? I want to show you the steps that it takes to become a Christian, to make Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life. The very first thing you have to do is to admit that you're a sinner. Tell God the things that you've done and sinned against Him. Specifically, tell Him what you've done. The next step is to repent. Now that means that you're going to turn away from your sin and turn towards God. Instead of loving your sin, you're going to love God instead. Then the next step is to ask God to forgive you of all the bad things that you've done. You also need to ask God to forgive you for not loving Him like you should have. Then finally, the last step is to commit your life to God. Start a new life by becoming a Jesus follower. You'll no longer be doing the things that you want or you feel like doing, but you will let God direct your life. You will seek to obey God. I urge you to come to Jesus. Now, before I go, I'd like to pray for each and every one of you. Pray with me. Oh, Father, I lift up every person who is listening today. I pray that they would open their heart and life to you. I pray that they would believe that I came and died on the cross for their sin. I pray that they would seek your forgiveness and surrender themselves to you. From that point on, Lord God, I pray that they would become a Jesus follower. Amen, and let it be so. And until the next time we see each other, remember, I love you.
Hello, children. Today, our verse is found in the book of John. It is John 3:16. John is in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Chapter 3, verse 16. John 3:16. While you're finding it in your Bibles, I'm going to tell you about the verse. You heard Jesus say this verse when he was talking to you a few minutes ago. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life." So let's talk about it a little bit. For God, God, the Almighty, the All-Powerful, the Creator of the universe, so loved, so much love, the world. That's all of us. That's me. That's you. That is everyone. He so much loved us that he gave his only Son. Now, the verse says only begotten. That begotten just means that it was his real son. It was not an adopted son. It was his actual son. His only son. So that whoever believes in him, believes means believing everything that you just heard here today. It means believing that he is God's son. It means believing that he came to earth because we are sinners. All of us are sinners. And he came because we're sinners, and he came to pay the price for that by dying on the cross. And he conquered death so that we could have eternal life. And if we believe that we are sinners, we repent and turn away from our sins, and we make him Lord of our life, accept that gift he gave us on the cross, then we won't perish forever. We will have eternal life. Our bodies might die. Perish means to die. But our souls, our essence, our beings will be in heaven with him forever and ever and ever. That's what everlasting life means. Now let's learn the verse. All right, children, repeat the verse after me. For God so loved the world,
for God so loved the world,
that he gave his only begotten Son,
that he gave his only begotten Son,
that whosoever believes in him,
that whosoever believes in him,
should not perish, but have everlasting life.
But have everlasting life.
John 3:16.
John 3:16.
Again, after me. For God so loved the world,
that God so loved the world,
that he gave his only begotten Son,
that he gave his only begotten Son,
that whosoever believes in him,
that whosoever believes in him,
should not perish,
should not perish,
but have everlasting life.
But have everlasting life.
John 3:16.
John 3:16.
Okay, say it with me this time. Y'all ready? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. John 3:16. All right, one more time with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. John 3:16. All right, now we're going to do some sign language to go with it. And here's how it goes. For, think of your forehead. For, we do this one all the time. God. Then it's so much. For God so loved the world. Make a W with both hands, world, and then make them go round and round like the world. The world. So let's put that together. For God so loved the world. And that he gave, that gift coming down, that he gave his only begotten, then son is like this. This means boy and then baby. So son, let's put that together. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That who, this is who, soever is like you're spraying something at your face. That whosoever, then you do, we've done this with Miss Stacy before too, so believes, that whosoever believes in him should not perish. So one hand is down and one hand is up, and then you flip them for dying, okay? Should not perish. So let's put it together that far. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish. Okay, and the next part is but. So it's a cross like something's ended, but then you open it up. It's not the end. Perishing is not the end. So, but have, we've got it, have, then everlasting, we're doing a circle, because a circle never ends, does it? So ever, then you do your thumb and your pinky, and it goes through the circle. Everlasting, and then life is the L's for life, and we do them on our body, our living bodies. Life. Not perish, but have everlasting life. All right, let's put it all together. Y'all ready? And we're going to say John 3:16 at the end of it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. John 3:16. All right, y'all do it with me. You ready? Let's do it together. Say it while you're doing the motions. Here we go. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. John 3:16. All right, let's do it again. Ready? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. John 3:16. All right, we're going to do it again. Are y'all ready? Let me really hear you kids. See if I can hear you while you're at home. You ready? Here we go. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. John 3:16. All right, kids, practice this verse. This is the life verse that you need to remember forever, because it tells us about God's love and about what he did for us so that we can live with him forever in heaven.
2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Scripture is so important to us because God uses this to not only tell us about what is important for us to do, but to correct us when we disobey. And so at Beach Club, we spend a lot of time in God's Word, memorizing it, studying it. And so one of the things we like to also do is to be able to find our scriptures, to be able to look them up, to be able to look up the stories that we're learning about. And so today we're going to spend a little bit of time in God's Word. To begin with, if you don't have your Bible, go get it, because we're going to need it. We're going to spend some time in it. In order to be able to find Bible verses, we need to know the books of the Bible. And so we've been going through a Bible book, New Testament song, that shares with us the books all the way from Matthew through Revelation. Now, some of you have already memorized all of your New Testament books, and some of you haven't. And so what you need to do if you don't know your books is go to the table of contents, which is in the front of your Bible. You can look at the Old Testament. We're not doing that today. We're doing the New Testament. Look at the New Testament. We're going to start with Matthew. We're going to go all the way through Revelation. So if you don't know your books, you can read them as we sing along. Again, we're going to go through the New Testament, and here we go. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John, Acts, Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, 1st Timothy, 2 Timothy, Titus, Philemon, Hebrews, James, 1 Peter, 2 Peter, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, Jude, and Revelations. Now that wasn't too bad, but it was a little slow. And I said it slow so you could articulate the words. I don't want Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John. I want Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John. But we're going to try it a little bit quicker this time. So spit those books out so I can hear them. Here we go. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John. Acts, Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, 1st Timothy, 2nd Timothy, Titus, Philemon, Hebrews, James, 1st Peter, 2nd Peter, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, Jude, and Revelations. Good job. Okay, now it's time to get your Bibles out. So get your Bible out. Okay, let's get our Bibles out and let's begin a little bit of Bible drill. The first thing that we always do is we remember this is God's Word. It's precious. It's something we always treat with respect. We don't drop it. We don't kick it. We don't smack it. But now there's a few commands that we go through with Bible drill, and I'm going to talk a little bit about those. The first is attention. And what I'm going to ask you all to do is to stand up straight and tall with the Bible in one hand. So when I say attention, I want all of you to do this. Now at home, go ahead and get your Bible. Stand up straight and tall. Attention. The next command is present Bibles. You'll have one hand above and one hand below. It doesn't matter whether you have the top up or down, but you're going to have one hand here, no fingers over the edge. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you, for example, a book like Matthew. Now, note, I didn't say start. When I say start, you're going to take your Bible, you're going to flip till you find the book of Matthew. You're going to take your index finger and point to any part of the page with Matthew and take one small step forward. So let's go over that again. Attention. Your Bible will be at your side. Present Bibles. Your Bible will be up top with one hand above and below. And the Bible should be flat. Like if I had something on the top, it wouldn't slide off. Not like this, like this. Present Bibles. Find the book of. Now, say the books with me, because we're going to stop at one of them. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. John, that's the book I want us to find. So we're going to start with the book of John. No, I didn't say start. Ready? Start. Good job. Now, Mom and Dad and those at home, I want you to look at where they have their index finger. Did they find the book of John? Because if they found anything other than the book of John, it's a mistake. So, let's try it again. Close your Bibles and come to attention. Present your Bibles. Help me out. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Acts, Romans. Romans is the book we're looking for this time. So attention, present your Bibles. Find the book of Romans. Start. Now the next question I have for you is, what is the book before the book you found? What's the book you found? And what's the book after you found? Well, you might say, let's see, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Acts, Romans, 1 Corinthians. Very good. So we want to not only know the book that we found, but the book before, the book and the book after. We're going to try one more. So attention, present Bibles. I want everyone with me now. Go through the books. Here we go. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians. Philippians is the book I want to find. So present your Bibles. The book is Philippians. Start. Did you find it? Keep hunting until you get it. Put your index finger down and step forward. Okay, who found it? What's the book before? Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Now, what if you don't remember? What do you do? Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John. Go through all the books until you get to the one right before, the book and the book after. Attention. Good job. I'd like to introduce to you something that we've been doing at Kids Beach Club all year long, and it's called a Hang 10. This is the front sheet and the back sheet. Hang 10 is all about hanging with God 10 minutes a day. Some of the boys and girls do this in the morning, some of them do it at night, but each week we get one of these. Each week it's a different color, each week it's a different focus. Each night, They have a Bible verse to look up. They have something to think about, to contemplate. And then they spend a little bit of time with Jesus, talking to him, because that's how we get to know him, through God's word and through talking and listening to him. And so this year, we've been doing this. We've had 24 different weeks that we have taken these home and spent time with Jesus. What I've asked the children to do is, as they take these and spend each night or each day, check it off. When they look up the Bible verse, write down the page, and then sign their name and turn them in. And we've got literally hundreds of hang tens that they filled out and turned in. You can see they're different colors, different names. And the reason I kept all these is because I wanted our teachers, I wanted you to be able to see this is a commitment that has been made by many, many children over many weeks. In fact, some of the children are so committed that when they don't show up, they have their friend bring their hang ten and get them their next one. This is something that's very important, and it really is important to me that they take it this serious. Now, I told them that at the end of the year, as a little bit of a reward, that what I would do is I've got a $10 Sonic gift card. Now, this isn't much of a reward, I realize, but I've appreciated their commitment. And so what I've asked Miss Donna to do is to come up here, and Miss Donna is going to go into all of these hundreds of hang tens and choose one. Kaylee Parker from the Black Orcas, I will be sending you this $10 Sonic gift card. Congratulations. And it's equally important, congratulations to everyone that took the time to spend it with Jesus. If you love somebody, you'll spend time with them, talking to them, and putting other things aside. Thank you so much for your commitment to Jesus.
Jesus loves me, this I know. Jesus loves me, he will stay close beside me.